Christmas, all the celebrations, and to have to deal with such loss. But Lord, you are the great companion. You are the great God who is compassionate for all. So Lord, be with them in this moment and strengthen them through this ordeal. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen, amen, amen.
How is everyone doing tonight? Doing good, doing good. We're going to have a short teaching. I always say short and I go longer than I say, but I'll try to keep it short tonight. So we've been just kind of recounting for us to remember what we've been dealing with. We've been on our series. I should say I have a sub-series and a super sub-series in that series that we've been on, but our overall series has been walking through the Bible and seeing Jesus in every page of Scripture, seeing Jesus in every book of the Word of God. We've been in the book of Leviticus for this past few months, and we've been basically trying to unpack what the revelation of the priesthood that was seen in the book of Leviticus and the tribe of Levi, which goes by the name, you know, from where we have the book of Leviticus, and how that all ties to Jesus, and how that shows Jesus who was to come. And we are in that sub-series and talking about the priesthood, comparing the priesthood, the old priesthood, the Aaronic priesthood, the Levitical priesthood, versus the Jesus priesthood, the priesthood of Melchizedek, right? And we've been talking about how there's a lot of similarities and overlaps between both priesthoods, and how we see it play out in our faith. I talked about how Jesus Christ is our great high priest, and how we are priests and kings in his kingdom, in his priesthood. He is the great high priest, but we are also, we have a position to play as priests in that priesthood that he has for us. And we've been talking about what the functions of priesthood have been. And last week we talked about the fact that the high priest performed inquiry from the Lord, inquiry on behalf of God's people. If God's people were to go after a certain decision, were to want to embark on a certain journey, they needed to inquire of the Lord, and it was the place of the high priest to be the bridge between God's people and God, and for him to go to God and say, Lord, what is it that you want us to do? And we talked about how Jesus has taken over that role in our dealings with God, and how he's become the bridge between God and us, and how we can inquire of the Lord daily and hear what God has to say about every decision we make in our life, so that we know that the decisions we're making are divine-based decisions. There are decisions that we could say, I walked in a way where I knew the Lord was leading me and the Lord was directing me. And so we move on from that onto the next function of a high priest and how Jesus reflects that today. How Jesus reflects that today. Today we'll be talking about the function called intercession. Amen. Intercession. So let's read Hebrews chapter 7, verse 25. Hebrews chapter 7, verse 25, when we see the Apostle Paul basically state this here as clear as anyone could ever state it. Basically state how Jesus continues this priesthood function in his new priesthood. Hebrews chapter 7, verse 25. Therefore, he is also able to save to the uttermost those who come to God through him, since he always lives to make intercession. All right, let's read it again. God, Jesus is able to save to the uttermost those who come to God through him, but there is a reason why he's able to do so. There is a reason why the salvation ministry that Jesus is in, right? We know that the ultimate thing that a high priest did and the ultimate thing that Jesus did is the same, right? The most important role of a high priest was to basically atone for the sins of the people. That was the most important thing, because if there was sin on the people, God could not say anything. They could not inquire of him because he would not respond because they're living in sin. He would not bless them because they're living in sin. Sin is a barrier between any man and God.
Amen.
Right? The Bible says in Isaiah, it says, my hand is not too short. My eyes are not blind. My ears is not deaf. I cannot see. I cannot reach out. But your sins have separated you from me. And Jesus bridges that divide by atoning for our sins, by paying for our sins. So we do know that the most important function of a high priest, both in the Aaronic order, the Levitical order, and in the Melchizedekian order under Jesus, is atonement for sins. But what's important in that verse we just read in Hebrews chapter 7, verse 25 is, Paul is basically saying, Jesus being able to atone for us is validated because, all right, we'll read it again. Therefore, he's also able to save to the uttermost those who come to God through him, since or because he always lives to make intercession for them. For such a high priest was fitting for us, one who is holy, harmless, undefiled, separate from sinners, and has become higher than the heavens, who does not need daily as those high priests to offer up sacrifices for his own sins and then for the people's. For this he did once for all when he offered up himself. So, he is able to save anyone who comes to God through him because he ever lives to make intercession for them.
Amen.
So Jesus' ministry of salvation is ever valid because he performs another high priest role, the role of intercession.
Amen.
So what is intercession? That's what we want to talk about today. What's that role that the high priest had as an intercessor? The role of the intercessor did not begin with the high priest, but was passed on to him after Moses could not handle all the responsibilities that was upon him. And this is one of the reasons why God passed on these roles from Moses to a high priest. Also added to that, Moses just could not stand the Israelites anymore. He had just had enough of them. I want you to remember this, and we're going to read this, and because actually David quotes this in the Psalms, but we're going to read it first in the account that it was first written in Numbers, or I should say, no, that's not Numbers, Exodus chapter 32, because it's before the priesthood, Exodus chapter 32, verse 9 to verse 14. Let's see what the children of Israel did. And let's see how Moses basically got tired of that role and why that role went on down to somebody else who was a high priest. Exodus chapter 32, verse 9. And the Lord said to Moses, I have seen this people, and indeed it is a stiff-necked people. Now therefore, let me alone, that my wrath may burn hot against them, and I may consume them. And I will make of you a great nation. So basically God is telling Moses, I'm going to destroy everybody else but you. And then from you,
amen,
I'm going to make a great nation. God is like, I can do whatever I want.
Yes, that's good. That's really good.
Then Moses pleaded with the Lord his God and said, Lord, why does your wrath burn hot against your people whom you have brought out of the land of Egypt with great power and with a mighty hand? Why should the Egyptians speak and say, he brought them out to harm them, to kill them in the mountains, and to consume them from the face of the earth? Lord, turn from your fierce wrath and relent from this harm to your people. Remember Abraham, Isaac, and Israel, or Jacob, your servants to whom you swore by your own self and said to them, I will multiply your descendants as the stars of heaven and all this land that I have spoken of and I have given it to your descendants and they shall inherit it forever. Verse 14. So the Lord relented from the harm which he said he would do to his people. Sorry, not trying to take a stab at Calvinism, but that's another verse. They say God is sovereign and does not change his mind. Verse 14 says he did. So
It's another scripture for
if you ever debate Calvinists. There you go. God can change his mind.
Amen.
God relented. That was not the first scripture. There's another scripture in Genesis where the Bible says, and the Lord repented of, and it doesn't mean to repent of sins, but basically to change his mind because Amen. Someone does something, yes. which Amen. Is what we're going to talk about. Someone intercedes.
Right. Amen.
All right? And we see this again because David, this story right here is so important. So I was preparing for this. I kind of caught this. That David actually requotes that story in his prayer to God. So let's go to Psalms 106, verse 23. Psalms 106. Actually, let's read from verse 19 because, you know, it basically gives the story again. So they made a calf in Horeb and worshipped the molded image. Thus they changed their glory into the image of an ox that eats grass. They forgot God, their Savior, who had done great things in Egypt. Now I want you to know that I'm going to come back to this, all right? Just put America in there, right? Just put America in that verse. They forgot God, their Savior, who had done great things in America. Wondrous works in the land of Ham, awesome things by the Red Sea. Therefore he said that he will destroy them. Listen. Had not Moses, his chosen one, stood before him in the breach. I love that word. Standing in the breach. Some versions say standing in the gap.
Yeah.
Had not Moses, his chosen one, stood before him in the breach to turn away his wrath, lest he destroy them.
Yeah.
So David is praying what we saw in Exodus.
Yeah. Amen. Amen.
Saying,
amen. Yeah.
If someone had not come in to stand in the gap for these people, the wrath of the Lord would have consumed them.
Yeah.
Well, I came to tell you, if Jesus had not stepped in to continually, as in Hebrews 7 verse 25, intercede on our behalf, the wrath of God would consume us. All right. Ezekiel chapter 22 verse 30. Ezekiel 22 verse 30. Standing in the gap. That was the role of the high priest. Exodus 22 verse 30. But to understand it very well, let's read from verse 28. Her prophets plastered them with untempered mortar, seeing false visions and divining lies for them, saying, thus says the Lord God, when the Lord had not spoken. The people of the land have used oppressions. This is all the sins they're committing, right? Committed robbery and mistreated the poor and the needy. And they wrongfully oppressed the stranger. So I sought for a man among them who would make a wall and stand in the gap before me on behalf of the land that I should not destroy it. But I found no one.
Amen.
And so because I found no one, verse 31, therefore I have poured out my indignation on them. I have consumed them with the fire of my wrath, and I have recompensed their deeds on their own heads, says the Lord God.
Yes.
So,
yes.
In the first instance, there was someone to stand in the gap,
yes.
to intercede, even though the people had done a great sin against God. In this instance, in Ezekiel, God said, I was trying to find somebody who would basically go on their knees and pray that I do not punish. But there was no one. Now you might ask, why does God need somebody to pray to get him to change his mind when he can change his mind? This is the reason. It's simple. God does not change who he is. God is always holy. God is always perfect. God has his laws. He's not going to change his laws.
Amen.
So he needs somebody who is going to be able to rework things so that people can stand holy in sight of the law.
Amen.
That's why I always said, I was talking about this with Pastor a few days back. The Lord never threw out the law.
That's right.
He never threw out the Ten Commandments.
Right.
He only said you cannot obey them all in your strength. So I'm going to find somebody who is going to stand in place for you, who is able to perfectly obey the law, so that they are qualified enough that when they intercede on your behalf, I will accept. And the punishment you were supposed to receive, you don't receive because somebody was praying for you.
Amen.
Somebody was standing praying for you. Hebrews 7 verse 25. For he intercedes.
Amen.
Not once. Because some people like to say, okay, he's interceded once for salvation. That's not what it said in Hebrews 7 verse 25. For he intercedes forever.
Yes.
The high priest had an important role of interceding for the people of God. Alright, let's see. Exodus chapter 20. Exodus chapter 20, verse 18. Now all the people witnessed the thunderings, the lightning flashes, the sound of the trumpet, the mountain smoking, and when the people saw it, they trembled and stood afar. Right? All the things that show that God is here. Then they said unto Moses, you speak with us and we will hear, but let not God speak with us lest we die. And Moses said to the people, do not fear, for God has come to test you, and that his fear may be before you, so that you may not sin. So the people stood afar off, but Moses drew near the thick darkness where God was. Then the Lord said unto Moses, thus you shall say to the children of Israel, you have seen that I have talked with you from heaven. So they said to Moses, we cannot stand in the gap. You stand in the gap. Because if we stand in the gap, God's holiness will devour us. Because God cannot stand on holiness.
Amen.
So we need somebody, like Ezekiel says, to stand in the gap.
Amen.
Stand in the trenches and intercede for us. Standing in the gap. The high priest's role was to intercede for the people of God. He had access to the Holy of Holies. So he could go before God. As you see that picture, it's a reflection of Jesus as the high priest right in front of the ark, the covenant, the mercy seat, right in front of him, the cherubims to his side, and he is lifting his hands as a great high priest, praying for you and for me. Because, my friends, we need prayers. Every day of our lives, we need prayers. Let's read a little bit more scriptures. Isaiah 53, verse 12. Isaiah 53, verse 12. Therefore I will divide him. Now this is, you know, it's Isaiah, so it's a prophecy of Jesus, right? Therefore I will divide him a portion with the great, and he shall divide a spoil with the strong, because he poured out his soul unto death, and he was numbered with the transgressors, and he bore the sin of many, and he did what? He made intercession for the transgressors.
Yeah.
That was Jesus. Only Jesus could qualify for that. Romans chapter 8 verse 26.
Oh yeah.
Romans 8, verse 26. Jesus, as our high priest, makes intercession to God on behalf of us. On our behalf. What a great ministry that is. Likewise, the Spirit also helps in our weaknesses. Verse 26 of chapter 8 in Romans. For we do not know what we should pray for as we ought, but the Spirit himself makes intercession for us with groanings which cannot be uttered. Now he who searches the hearts knows what the mind of the Spirit is, because he makes intercession for the saints according to the will of God. Okay, so only God can perfectly make an intercession that's perfectly aligned with the will of God. That is why we Pentecostals believe in praying in the Holy Spirit. And in praying in the Holy Spirit, we're saying, what are you doing? You're sinking. You're sinking. thinking. You're synchronizing yourself with the Holy Spirit, because the normal English language is not sophisticated enough to understand and properly break down the complications of the language of heaven. So you need a heavenly language.
Amen.
That you can communicate on.
Yes.
And the Holy Spirit can go, yes, I am pouring out myself on you. I am stirring you up. I am stirring up your spirit. So when you pray in the Holy Ghost, you charge up your spirit, because your spirit man, your inner man, is connected to the Holy Spirit, who is continually interceding on your behalf. Remember, I talked last week about how the Holy Spirit represents Jesus on the earth revealed. So we know that the Spirit of God is the Spirit of Jesus Christ. There is no separation there, as we talked about last week, and saw through Scripture. So he intercedes for us. He intercedes for us continually. While we are seated here, Jesus in heaven is interceding on our behalf before the Father, praying for you, praying for Stoney, my son. Stoney, I am praying for you, Stoney, that you will finish the race. I am praying for you, brother Tony, that you will fight the fight of faith and hold on to the prize for which he has called you. He is praying for you, Joy, that you hold on to him in the midst of your despair. He's praying for you, brother Mark, that in the midst of your temptation, you will not fall and give in to the tricks of the enemy, but that you will stand strong. He is ever praying for you. He said to Peter, but I have prayed for you. The devil has sought to sift you, but I have prayed for you.
That's true. Amen.
Jesus is praying for us.
Amen.
He is interceding for us. Why? Because on our own, we cannot do it. So he's up there in heaven as high priest, pushing us on, saying, come on, keep fighting. Keep fighting this good fight of faith.
Right.
He knows you're going to get to a stop, a bump in your life, but he's telling you, Stoney, keep going on. Keep fighting the good fight of faith. Lay hold to the prize. And Hebrews, another scripture says, he knows, because he's connected to our feelings. That's why he had to come to the earth. He understands the pains that we experience, the losses of a loved one. He understands that. And so he prays for us through that. Don't ever believe the lie that the Lord ever forsakes you or leaves you alone.
Amen.
He doesn't. He is always interceding on your behalf.
Amen.
Praying for you. Praying for you. Praying for you.
Amen.
In that same chapter, verse 34. Actually, let's read from verse 33. Who shall bring the charge against God's elect? It is God who justifies. Who is he who condemns? It is Christ who died, and furthermore is also risen, who is even at the right hand of God, who also makes intercession for us. Why do you see this continuing theme of Christ making intercession? It is because Christ makes intercession that Paul was able to confidently say what he said in verse 35, which is a scripture we all know. Who shall separate us from the love of Christ? Shall tribulation, or distress, or persecution, or famine, or nakedness, or peril, or sword? Nothing.
That's right.
Neither height nor depth, verse 39, nor any created thing shall be able to separate us from the love of God, which is in Christ Jesus our Lord. Because he's praying for us.
Oh God. Yes. Amen.
He's holding you up.
Amen.
In your weak moments, in your trying moments in your life, Jesus is there praying for you, holding you up, interceding on your behalf, saying, you've got this. Fight, oh Christian, fight. Stand up. You can overcome. You are more than conquerors through me, your Lord and Savior. He's praying for you. Praying continually, constantly for us. And so that's why we as priests under his priesthood cannot just say, thank you, Lord, for praying for us. We ought to pray for others. We ought to intercede for others. I brought this book because I was about 14 when I first read it. Touch the World Through Prayer, Wesley L. Duell. And it remarkably changed my life when I did. I was doing a personal fast. I think it was a 3-day fast I was doing. And I read that book in that time. I was 13 or 14. And it changed my mind about what prayer was. Because a lot of times, and I'm concluding with this, right? A lot of times we think, all right, there's this great evangelist. You know, when Billy Graham was preaching out there, and he's doing all these miracles and all these things, or, you know, Ryan Hart Bunkie or T.L. Osborne or, you know, Oral Roberts, all these banging, all these great evangelists, and they're doing amazing things, and they're doing miracles and healings. And what we don't forget, what we forget is that there are people behind the scenes constantly interceding and praying that those outreaches will be successful. So you can say, how maybe the Lord God called you only to Edmond, Oklahoma. But I don't believe the Lord God called anybody to Edmond, Oklahoma alone. I believe he called us to the whole world. That doesn't mean you should take the next flight to Mombasa, Kenya, or Bombay, India tomorrow morning to go preach the gospel. It means that you can be a partner of the gospel of Jesus Christ by doing something you don't have to pay for. Get on your knees and pray. Pray. He was writing something in this book, and he talked about how when Billy Graham, he said he had never met Billy Graham before, but he would continually pray that when Billy Graham would speak in a crusade, that people would be saved. He was on his knees praying. He talked to, there was a story he talked about. He was like, I was in a meeting somewhere in Indiana, and this woman drove so many miles on a wintry, a cold night for Sunday service. And after the service, she walked up to him and she says, I have been praying for you for years.
Amen.
And sometimes we see things happen in ministry. Pastor, you see this a lot. And you wonder, how did God set up such a perfect moment that seems like a coincidence? Somebody out there you don't know was praying that God would use you for his glory. So you want to reach people around the world, in North Korea, in China, in India. There is a globe right here I brought. Turn it around. I love geography. I love geography and history, right? And I like a new thing my wife does is when she wants to wake me up, she basically asks me capitals of the countries around the world. It's a good practice. It's been a good thing we've got going on. Because she figured out the other ways of waking me up does not really wake me up. But when she says, oh, what's the capital of Sri Lanka? Oh, boom, I'm up. I'm like, yeah, I know that. Right? And you go through the whole world and there's over 200 countries in the world. All of you have globes at your, you know, in your house. You have maps all around the world. Over 210 countries around the world. You might never be able to visit all of those countries, all of these countries around the globe.
That's right.
But there is something that you can do as a priest under the priesthood of Jesus Christ. You can get on your knees and you can pray. Missionaries in India, Lord, as they preach, let the gospel touch the hearts of people. Amen. You can pray, Lord, for those missionaries in China, as they reach out, Lord, let it touch. May you open doors in Iran. It may seem like a place right now where the gospel is not breaking through, but God, look, think about it. Think about it, right? I wasn't born at this time, but you read a lot of, like I said, I love history. You read a lot of history of the Cold War. And, you know, I listened to some of the old radio signals that used to, basically, the U.S. used to basically try and, you know, parch across Eastern Europe. You know, the USSR, Soviet Union, all those communist nations, you know, Ukraine, Belarus, Latvia, and places like that. And the dedication people had to preaching the gospel in those places. Now, the gospel is open in a lot of those places that 30 years ago, you could not be preached, you could not preach outside because they would arrest you. The cops would arrest you.
That's right.
Now, the gospel is able to be spread there. And so you might think, oh, well, okay, Iran, North Korea, Saudi Arabia, these places, it's going to be impossible for the gospel to be spread. It's going to be impossible if the children of God do not pray for it. If we don't intercede for it, then it's going to be impossible. But if we pray, then God is going to move. Remember what we read in Ezekiel? He says, I was looking for a man to stand in the breach, but I could find none.
Yep.
So the question God is asking to you tonight is, I am looking to open a door into Saudi Arabia, into places in India, into North Korea, into Iran, the country we seem to hate the most. But where are the people interceding for it? And he only needs one person. Someone devoted to interceding for it. I'm going to round off with this story. Pastor said I should always tell this story, so I will.
Amen.
It's a story of Reinhard Bonnke. I don't know, you know, Reinhard Bonnke, great evangelist, 79 million decisions in his ministry for Christ. 79 million.
That's right.
But broke all the records you could think about. You know, if you go on YouTube, look at his videos, they pan the cameras, 2.3 million people per night would come to his crusade. In Nigeria, where I went for his crusade, I went there, and it was out in the beach of a river. You could not see the end. It was like, it's like just sands. That's how many the people were. These were people that God brought. Ryan Bonke basically turned Africa from worshiping idols and gods into serving Jesus Christ in the span of 40, 50 years. T.L. Osborne, great things he did. But what people forget, right? There's a lot of stories, you know. In Ryan Bonke's ministry, he always talks about how the dead were raised and everything, you know, and awesome things God did through his ministry. But here is what people just jump and don't realize. In one of the stories about someone being raised from the dead in his crusades, it was not actually Ryan Bonke who raised the man from the dead. It wasn't. What happened was, during the crusade, here was this woman, her husband had an accident. Go look it up on YouTube and watch it. Her husband had an accident and he dies in the accident. If you know anything about African Christians, is that we take our faith overboard, right? It's like, okay, just go overboard with it. And she would not take her husband to the mortuary. She's like, no, he's going to rise up. She wheeled her husband into this crusade, and she says, God is going to raise my husband through Ryan Bonke. Because God is working miracles through this man. And in Ryan Bonke's crusades, what they will do is, Ryan Bonke, his strategy was to basically try to use all the churches and stuff in the area, have all the pastors, and so they would reach out. You know, it's very similar to what Billy Graham did, but in even a larger context. But during his crusades, there would be people that were praying behind the scenes from about 7 a.m. in the morning to 12 p.m. praying. While the crusade was going on, there were tens and tens of people in the rooms praying. They were not doing anything in the crusade. All they were doing were praying, saying, God, move. God, have your way. God, work your miracles. God. And so they didn't want to take this corpse to the altar because, I mean, where are you going to put this guy? This is a dead corpse. And they took this corpse to the pastor's office somewhere, you know, the section where the pastor was situated, and they were praying. And they prayed for 7 hours straight. 7 hours. You can go watch this on YouTube. It's a Ryan Bonke. He actually did a documentary about it. 7 hours they prayed, and this guy rose up from the dead. Now you may say, oh, study, that's big. Well, I'll tell you, my dad called me four or five years ago, right? And he says, Stoney, you cannot believe what just happened. A young pastor in the church in Nigeria died. And he came back to life. How? Okay. Like I said, Africans can be very radical in their faith sometimes. Yeah. This guy died. His mother didn't say, oh, he was about to die. She didn't say, oh, let's rush him to the hospital. No, she didn't. She was like, take him to the altar. Let's call the pastor and all the pastors of the church, and we're going to pray. And they took this guy. His name is Brother Chima, right? They took him. So he was a friend of mine when we were growing up, so I know this guy very well. Took him up to the altar. They prayed for 7.5 hours that he would rise up from the dead. About 7 people in the pastoral team just prayed nonstop. This guy, right, you have to rise up from the dead. And yes, lo and behold, he's living today. He's alive. So his heartbeat was gone. His body had become already cold, dead. Resurrected. Because people dared to pray.
Yeah.
People dared to intercede. You think God cannot change America?
Amen.
He can. But his people need to pray.
Amen.
His people need to intercede. It may look impossible. It may look... Think about this. Instead of taking that 10 minutes to go on conservative website or comments and write about how the leftists are taking out the country and destroying the whole country. You know what? What would be more productive? Would you spend in that same time on your knees saying, God, I know the devil wants to destroy this country, but you can save it.
Amen. Amen.
Raise new Joshuas, raise new Daniels, raise new Moseses, raise new Calebs that will rise and stand, intercede so you can touch the world through prayer. So I challenge you tonight. Every single day in your prayer routine, well, I'm going to incorporate this into mine. Pick a, country. Look on your maps at home. Pick a state. Pick a country. And pray. Say, God, let the gospel turn this country around.
Yes.
Amen.
Every single day, change it up. Pray. You will not know, but you don't know what evangelist you are out there helping with your intercession.
Amen.
You don't know what missionary you're out there helping with. You don't know what pastor you are out there helping with. You don't know someone who's praying over the sick, who it's not because of just that prayer they prayed and that person got healed. It was because you were praying. So let's follow in the priesthood of Jesus Christ. And as he has interceded for us, let's intercede for the world. Let's intercede for others. Let's intercede for our families. Leave no stones unturned. Amen. Let's pray. Father, we thank you tonight. We thank you because you are the great high priest, and we thank you that you continually intercede on our behalf. You're continually praying for us. You're continually standing in the gap for us. You're continually right there by the right hand side of the Father, praying for each and every one of your children, that we will hold on to the faith, that we will contend for the faith, that we will stand strong in the face of adversity. Lord, teach us how to pray. Just like the disciples asked, teach us, Lord, how to pray. May we learn that today. May we learn to pray for our nation continually. May we learn to pray for our states, our cities, all the countries around the world, ministries, missionaries, Christian organizations, outreaches. Lord, may we learn to pray that the gospel will be unstoppable, because when we pray, you move mountains. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. All right. We have questions and thoughts this evening.
Tony, I just want to stone you. Stone.
Jesus.
You know, you're talking about intercession. Dean Heifel came to my office today. Ron knows him well, and one of the other Gideons in the area. And I was so pumped up. They came in to pray for me, which they do. They pick a pastor, and you know, they go to the office and pray. I have high regard for the Gideons, but I was so pumped up that they probably wondered what was wrong with me. But I said, you know, there is some people that I have been praying for 10, 13 years. Mm-hmm. And I have prayed, and about 4 weeks ago, I was praying. I said, Lord, I prayed for these people so long. Am I wasting my time? And I kind of get discouraged praying about it, but, you know, I love people, so I continue to pray. And then all of a sudden, I have seen in their lives about a 190-degree turn.
Amen.
And amen. They are coming back to God.
Amen.
And I'm just flabbergasted. But I know you do not quit interceding.
Yes.
There's some other people that I'm interceding for right now. And I say, God, I don't know how to tell you to deal with it. You're God, I'm not.
Yeah.
Get a hold of their hearts and bring them to the cross.
Yes.
And I believe God's going to do it. I mean, they may be stubborn. They may be kicking, locking their heels like a Missouri mule in the ground and refusing to budge. But mm-hmm. God can move people that nothing else can move.
Yes. Amen. Isn't that powerful?
Yeah.
Isn't that powerful? Intercession really is. Any other thoughts? Any other questions? Yes.
Well, Tony, I was calling Tony too.
Now that's just a tease.
as a young teenager, we were having church in my church where I grew up. And the pastor got a call during his sermon that the lady that went to our church that lived down the street on the corner had died. And the family called and said, we want you to come pray. Well, they'd already pronounced her dead. wasn't going to let her leave till the preacher came down and prayed. So he asked the deacons, he said, whoever has the faith that she can be raised from the dead, you come, but nobody else. I don't want anybody that doubts. And he said, had us church people sit there, and he said, you stay till we come back. Hmm. They were gone 2 hours. Of course, we were praying all that time, you know. They came back in 2 hours, and she had been raised from the dead.
Wow. Hey, it works in America, too, people.
Yeah. When we were in Bristol, we had a youth group that had about 300 enrolled in it. Our youth pastor was going to take them down the Illinois River, and I knew that it was at flood stage, and I really was unfavorable, and I tried to talk to him about it. He said, I've already put money down on the lodge down there where they're staying at, and they're having a service the night before, and Wanda Harper, our children's church director, she was probably in her 70s, and she just had to go with the youth group. Mm-hmm. And she went down there, and my youth pastor said, Pastor Randall, Wanda died during the service. And he said, those young people gathered around her and prayed. There was every indication of death. And God raised her up, and she lived many more years after that.
Wow.
So God answers young people's prayers as well as older people's prayers.
Oh, yes.
When they intercede for them. I don't know how long they prayed. I never asked Thomas. His name's Thomas Dale. He's academic director for some Bible college now. But he was touched.
Yeah.
And I was thrilled. And then we went ahead and got on the river, and the miraculous of miracles was the Illinois River was pretty much at flood stage, and we made 12 hours in 3 hours because of the rapidity of the water current running. But the miracle was that nobody drowned, and we had kids in that youth group that couldn't row a canoe. They could no more row a canoe.
Yeah.
We had two brothers.
Wow.
They weren't real bright. and I don't know how they ever got to the end of that river, but God.
It was God.
God has his hand upon his children, and God kept these kids safe. We had a couple of young ladies, very smart young ladies, and by the time they got to the end of the river, they looked like drowning grass. Right. And nobody lost their lives.
Amen.
And I didn't have to do any funerals of young people that we lost.
Wow.
And I thank God.
Wow. Praise God. Isn't it amazing?
Tony,
yes.
The bottom line is God wants partners.
Yes. Amen.
Say that again, Doris.
God wants partners.
Oh, yes.
Oh, yes.
Yes. Hey, that's good. That'll preach.
That'll preach right there. I mean, that encapsulates everything we've been saying. He needs you, right? He can do things, but he needs you. He needs you. He needs you to pray. He needs
that's
you to partner.
Title of your sermon.
Yeah. Yeah. Amen. Yes. Yes. Amen. All right. God bless y'all. We'll see you on Sunday.
Amen. Thanks, Tony. Stoney.
Not Tony.
I ought to make it a piece because Darlene always called you Mr. T. Tony, darling, good to see you all tonight. David, good to see you tonight. Mark, good to see you tonight. Hey, you didn't have to leave.
I won't be here
until thanks for coming.
Really nice building.
That's what we want.
Yeah.
Wow, look at that.
My sister never got over her cough. I used to for a long time. If we went from she hadn't done that much longer since she broke the leg.
Is it a remote?